All right. Hey guys, good morning. Woo! Welcome to October 1 and the first day of quarter four. So, and welcome to business planning for 2023. So thank you guys for sharing your Saturday here with us. Hopefully you guys come away with some good tips. And this is part one on building our business plan. So we're going to be talking a lot about like how to build it, what it should look like. But to be quite honest with you guys, there's going to be a ton of homework that you have to do before coming back to part two and kind of plugging in your numbers and deciding like what it is that you want to do, where you want to spend your money, what you want to do for education, what conferences you want to go to, how many deals you need to do to get to the financial goal that you're trying to reach for 2023. So I actually love it when quarters start on the first of the month because I'm that girl that's like, oh, I'm going to start on Monday, right? So I am, I'm one of those people, but I do really love that October 1st is lining up with quarter four. But I want to talk a little bit about quarters and real estate and kind of how it affects your business. So quarter four, things start to slow down. Does anybody know why?
Yeah.
Holidays, right? So as we start to wind down, as we start to slide into the end of the year, two things happen. Buyers and sellers kind of say, well, you know what? I'm just going to wait, right? I'm just going to wait till January. And realtors start to do this. Oh, I didn't really achieve everything I wanted to in 2022. And you know what? I'm just going to enjoy my family. And in January, I'm going to start out with a bang. But what happens when you do that? When you wait until January to start, right? Don't forget, real estate is like planting a garden. You got to plant the seeds. You got to wait for them to grow. So if you wait until January to really start your business and start your career, and I'm going to do all these new things, you're really kind of doing a disservice to yourself because you're not going to see the reaps of you're not going to see the benefits of what you're doing there until almost quarter two. Right? So we really get to take quarter four and still achieve some of the goals that we want to do in 2022, but we really want to spend the right amount of time in planning 2023. And when we talk about the stuff that we're going to be talking about in the next 4 hours, you can start implementing that stuff right away. Start planting those seeds so that January is a really good month for you guys. January is in our office and most of it in real estate companies is the slowest month of the year. Anybody know what the second slowest month is? You guys will be seeing this in our office and next week in our branch meeting.
September.
Why is September such a slow month in real estate? Yeah, but they're going back to school in September. So that wouldn't be in line because remember, you have to plant the seeds and let them grow. So hurricanes. But why is September the slowest month? What was everybody do? If you're going to close deals in September, when are you going under contract?
August,
end of July. What are people doing in the end of July and August? Taking vacations, exactly, right? So you guys are going to see when we pull our numbers next Friday at our branch meeting, you're going to see September, you know, it tends to be a slower month, but January is the first. But we are going to redesign this whole entire thing. We're going to come out and have January be one of our strongest months if we apply exactly what it is that we're going to be covering today. Okay, so what are we going to be talking about today? So a couple of things. So again, we're going to kind of look at like, for those of you who never built a business plan or like, how do I build it? Especially for new agents, like, I don't even know how to, like, what should my numbers be if I just started, right? But we're going to kind of teach you how to figure that out. We're going to take a look at 2022 and kind of talk about what worked, what didn't work, what got in the way, what we didn't do, what we wanted to do and all that. Because that's important because you're never going to change and improve what you're doing unless you can really look back and see what it is that's holding you back, right, from reaching those goals. And then we're going to talk a lot today about some new lead generation ideas. And they're not new to the industry, and nothing that we're going to talk about today is new, or I didn't invent any of this stuff, but it might be new to you, or it might be something that you never thought of, or something that you didn't implement in 2022 for lead generation that you want to start in 2023. But I really want you guys to understand that this is not like, okay, I'm here for 4 hours with Carrie today. And now I have my rock solid business plan. It's going to take a lot of homework from you guys, as it should, right? Like, you don't want to build your business plan in 4 hours anyway. You want to take the time and really research, do your, you know, really in look at yourself too, and kind of figure out, you know, what it is that you guys want to accomplish. All right. Sound good? All right. Well, that was lame. Sound good?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. All right, so I made this little workbook today and I also have a PowerPoint. So we're gonna be jumping back and forth on and off with this. Lights are gonna be on and off in this office when the lights go off and then they go back on. It's gonna really wake you guys up. So you guys, you know, use this to take notes. And if anybody needs a clean one of these to actually write your business plan later, just, you know, let me know and we'll photocopy one for you today. But actually use this to take notes if you want, or take notes wherever you want to see. Reese has taken his notes on his tablet. All right. So we're going to open up to the first page and we're going to talk about, let me make sure my PowerPoint. Okay. So we kind of talked about that. Let's talk about mission statement. Nestor, can you hit the lights? So every good business plan has a mission statement, because you have to understand what it is that you're building. Real estate is so big, right? It's so many facets of real estate. You could be, you know, focusing on VAs, first-time homebuyers, whatever that is, but we need to have a mission statement. So I love this, because sometimes people will say, you know, they'll talk about what their mission statement is, and it'll be like a big, huge paragraph. A mission statement is one sentence. Okay, so who wants to read definition of a mission statement up there? Anna said, Ever, go ahead. You already started.
Mission statement is a single sentence that describes a company's fundamental purpose by explaining why the business exists. It articulates to employees and the public what the company's purpose is. Mission statements are incredibly varied because they are unique to each company. However, they all broadly illustrate the present capabilities, customer focus, and the products and services that the company produces.
Awesome. All right, so here's some examples of some mission statements, okay? Anna, why don't you read these? Honey Goods, we don't know what that is, but it's a company, all right? So we don't know, but maybe we're gonna learn about what Honey Goods does. Awesome.
Outgoing Kids University exists to provide educational services, allowing every child to succeed in learning and life. Exploration Air, to inspire humanity's mind and imagination. Care Creation, to reinvent how people buy cars. Open World, build the most useful product, respect every living creature, use business to motivate and execute solutions to the global environmental crisis. And Healthy Green, to spread the power of self-care and inspire people to live healthier by connecting communities to real food.
Awesome. So you see, like, these two last ones are kind of long, and this one's super short, but they're all one sentence. So it's one sentence that really defines you, okay? So what we're going to do now is, Nestor, if you could turn the lights back on. I want you guys to pair up with somebody, and I'll be nice. You can pair up with somebody that you know. And Nestor's going to turn the music on for a couple minutes, and we're going to talk, we're going to take just a couple of minutes. You guys, we're going to take a couple of minutes to talk about this with your partner, but this is like homework assignment number one. You're not going to come out with your final mission statement today, but you're going to start talking about it. This is homework assignment number one. This is really the first step in building your business plan. So go ahead and pick a partner and just talk about this for about 2 to 3 minutes.
Okay.
All right, 1 minute. All right, 20 seconds. All right, you guys, wrap it up. All right, awesome. Good job, you guys. So again, this isn't something that you're gonna just walk away today and like, oh, I created. I want you guys to spend time on this. Again, this is homework assignment number one that you're gonna be working on after the fact. All right, who wants to share what they have so far? Hermes, someone's pointing at you. So you can get mad at your partner, but why don't you go ahead and share your mission statement?
You said a house without a home without a family.
A house is not a home without a family. Okay, all right. Who else wants to share like that? Maria, you already did yours. So what was your mission statement that you did on the plane? Back from Italy, by the way, everyone. She was working. She's like, I didn't even wait till I got back to U.S. soil before I started working on my business plan.
Okay, so my business plan.
Just the mission statement.
My mission statement has been always since I started real estate is to help people to achieve their financial freedom through the real estate investment properties to have a passive income that allows them to retire early.
Awesome. Okay, one more share. Tiffany.
Good morning, everyone. Sorry, Allison. The home ownership is their right of passage. That's all I got. Sorry.
I love it. I was looking at Nestor because of the music. Okay. Why is that on? Okay, cool. All right, so I'm gonna comment a little bit more on those mission statements, but I'm gonna jump to the next slide. Nestor, if you can hit the light. So we also, you wanna have a mission statement, like what your business does. But then there's also something called the tagline, right? So a tagline is really kind of what identifies your brand. So who wants to go ahead and read these taglines? Maria.
Just do it.
Right, Nike, right? We all know that one. Just do it. So that's a tagline.
Real leather crafted the forgotten way.
Yep, Hyde sign. I don't know who that is, but that's their tagline.
Shave money.
Yes.
That's a good one.
Dollar Shave Club. Never heard of them, but that's a cool tagline.
Melt in your mouth, not in your hands.
Right? Now everyone knows this one, Eminem. Melt in your mouth, not in your hands, right? You think, you hear that tagline, you don't even need to know.
Yeah.
You know that it's Eminem, right?
It's more than good, it's great.
It's more than good, it's great, right? Frosted Flakes.
Okay. With a name like Muffers, it has to be good.
Yeah, you guys know that one, right? With a name like Smuckers, it has to be good. So that's their tagline.
Ball of the Rock is
Yeah.
Quality never goes out of style.
Levi's.
It keeps going and going and going.
Right? Energizer Bunny. Going and going. The bottom one is, I can't read it either because my thing is in front of it, but you guys get the thing. So your tagline is kind of like your personal brand, like it, one quick little thing. So yes,
I have one and I use it as my hashtag.
Yes
Do it right with white.
Yes. And explain but explain that, because maybe some people don't know your last name.
Oh, Mitzi White.
Her last name is White, right? So do it right with white. So Tiffany, tell me your mission statement again.
Home ownership is a rite of passage.
I think that's your tagline.
They tell, well, my tagline is closed at home.
Okay, I like that one too.
Okay.
Hermes, what was your mission statement?
The house is not at home without a family.
Kind of like that as a tagline.
Yeah, okay. Well, yeah.
So, I mean, you guys can work on this, and again, but, you know, it, and I'm not trying to tell you what you should or shouldn't do. I'm just telling you basically the definition. So,
right, yeah.
All right. So what I want you guys to do, well, Nestor will turn the lights back on, and just for like 1 or 2 minutes, partner up with somebody else. You guys are going to move around a little bit, but that's why we have chairs with wheels. So you can spin around. So work with a different partner that you just didn't work with. And work on your tagline for 1 or 2 minutes, kind of come up with ideas, share with each other, and work together on that. For you. Yep. As a real estate agent. You guys, just real quick, because Maurice brought up a good point. He's like, I kind of already have this from what I did before. Yes, if you already have a tagline and a mission statement, that's not going to change your year. Maybe it'll change. Maybe you change some stuff around, but especially your tagline, you want that to be start that to be part of your personal brand. So that should be like, do it right with white. She's not going to come up with a new one in 2024. That's awesome. And that's aligned with her, and people are going to recognize that. So, all right. Yes.
Work with white.
Nice.
I like that.
I love it. Cool. All right.
Go ahead.
Okay, so I have a couple. So I have building a lifetime
relationship with my family at the time, and then I was playing with Chauncey sold it.
Love it. So do they're the first ones slower though. So we can hear.
Relationships with family at the time.
Okay, I love that. I love that. Who else wants to share? Tagline. Ice wants to share Evers.
Always ever homes forever.
What is it?
With ever homes forever.
With ever homes forever. I love that. That's awesome. All right. One more share. Jean. Let's get the house for you. Let's do it. I love it. Awesome. All right, cool. So you guys, we're still on this first page, right? So we talked about our mission statement. You still want to kind of work on your tagline, perfect that. The next thing that you guys really want to identify is your values and your why. So they say, and there's, you know, a lot of videos you guys can watch online about this. People are not going to work with you because you work for La Rosa Realty. They're not. They're going to work with you because of who you are and what your why is and what you believe in, right? So I want you guys to take, you're going to do it by yourself. So this exercise, you're not going to pair up, but I want you to kind of write out your why. And also above that, because we're going to do both kind of at the same time, what are your values? So Nestor, if you can hit the lights real quick. So what are your values? So these are some values, you guys. I'm not saying these should be your values, but sometimes people are like, what are values? Here's a list of some values that might apply to you, right? Accepting, adaptability, freedom, gratitude, understanding, spirituality, service, responsibility, leadership, knowledge, innovation. So these are, you know, values is like kind of like one word, right? So what we're going to do in a minute, we're going to journal. And again, this is an exercise you're going to take home. This is homework assignment. I've already given you like four. This is going to be homework assignment number five. Is really kind of journal about like what your values are. When you can establish what your values are, it really helps you identify what your why is, okay? So Nestor will turn the lights on, music up, and you guys are going to do this exercise solo for about 3 to 4 minutes. You're going to journal about what your why is and kind of identify what your core values are. Values are like words, like my values are, you know, dependability, honesty, innovation. So they're like one word. That's why I put these up here as example, like purpose, responsibility, uniqueness. And these can apply to you as a person, but they, you know, also your business. I mean, hopefully who you are as a person is who you are in your business. We don't want to be playing Jekyll and Hyde here. And really who you are as a person is what you're going to carry forward in your business. That's why people are going to want to work with you. And then your why. Why are you in real estate? Why are you in business? So sometimes people are like, I don't know why I'm in real estate, but why are you in business? Who are you doing this for? Are you doing it just for yourself? Is this for other people?
Thank you.
All right, one more minute, one more minute. All right, Nestor. Nah, no lights, just music. All right, cool. Anybody want to share your values or your why? It could be one or the other. Awesome.
My why is creating a legacy for my family while giving opportunities to others.
Awesome, I love that. I love that. That's awesome. Very good. Someone else. Someone who hasn't shared yet, Ice.
So my values is love, leadership, family, power, compassion, honesty, responsibility. I know how good the word is. Unstoppable.
That is a word. I love that word. Yeah, unstoppable.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Okay. I want to help people accomplish their goals, and I want to take new challenges every day.
Nice. I love that. Awesome. Awesome. Karen.
So my values, I have gratitude, happiness, freedom, love, communication, education, integrity, and compassion. My wives are kind of funny because I feel like they are a little bit different from each other. But the main one is the freedom to be in my kids' life as mm-hmm. much as I wanted to be. And then also like having a business because I am a mom and I am a wife, but I think it helps define me as just like a woman and be able to like show people you can have it all.
Yeah.
Be the business, be the mom, be the wife.
Yes, you can. Awesome. All right, one more share. Nestor, what's your why?
You.
Be careful, Nestor.
Tread lightly. The people online are confused. All right, awesome. Okay, so again, you guys, this is just a small exercise to start, but like I said, I really encourage that you guys do this at home as well. Okay, so we're gonna start to get into kind of what your accomplishments were in 2022, what got you there, and where you fell short, right? This is gonna segue us into really talking about lead generation. So there was a realtor experiment. So I wanna tell you about this now because I want you to really kind of be thinking about this as we kind of move into the next section. So this group of people, they went into, it doesn't matter, it's just me talking. So this group of people went into this area, right? I don't know how large the area is, but probably like a zip code. And they did a poll of like, who is the number one real estate agent in that area? Mm-hmm. And people were putting down, this person, that person, and really one person didn't outweigh anybody else, right? You guys might have seen this video, it's been kind of circulating on social media. So they had, 10, 11 people, like with a couple different votes each, but not like really one person that stood out. Then this group of people created a fake profile. They created a fake person as a fake realtor, and they sent out 8 postcards. It was like the 8x8 campaign. So they sent out 8 postcards once a month for 8 months, and all about this person and being the realtor. Then they went back into that area and they asked, who's the number one real estate agent in the area? And I mean, you know where the story's leading. Who did they pick? Everyone picked the fake person, right? It is crazy. That person had never done a sale. They've never closed the deal. The person doesn't even exist. And yet this, What? Nestor, thank you so much. Okay, so, but everybody even me was like, John Smith is the number one real estate agent in our area, okay? So this is really to kind of gear you guys towards what it is that you really need to do in order to stand out in your business. Now, I'm sorry, I'm going to pick on people, but like, if a fake person can be the number one realtor in their community, Mitzi can be the number one person in Silver Springs or whatever it is out there. Michelle, you know, Jupiter.
Silver Lake,
sorry.
My neighbor.
Yeah. I mean, it is possible, right? But you have to do the work and you have to be top of mind and you have to put in the effort. So here at La Rosa, I mean, you know, we always try to tell you guys, like, don't spend money. Let's do these things as free as possible. Eventually, you have to spend money. But when you're new and you don't have any money to spend, you only can do the lead generation activities that don't cost any money or that much money. But eventually, you want to get into a position in your business where you're taking some of those dollars of your closings and putting it into what's called your marketing budget and kind of spending that money on marketing, right? So what I don't want you guys to be in the mindset as we move through this next section is, well, I'll never be, we're going to plan as if we are going to have the money coming in and we're going to designate how much it's going to go towards maybe a postcard campaign or maybe paying someone to do something for you online, social media and such, okay? So just remember this experiment as we kind of move through these next parts. Okay, so now we get to kind of celebrate our wins in 2022. And if you don't have any wins, I don't believe you, because everybody has something to celebrate, whether it's, I finally passed my real estate license and had the nerve to go interview with somebody and join a family, okay? So what you guys are going to do is take another 2 minutes. Again, you're all going to be repeating these exercises at home when you're really working on your business plan, but start to really write down your accomplishments in 2022. So Nestor's going to turn the music up. You're not going to work in partners for this. You're going to work in on yourself and just kind of journal for a couple minutes what your accomplishments were in 2022. Celebrate those wins. So that would be on this. I don't think there's a page for that. So just do it on the back of that other page. Oh, there is? Okay, mine doesn't have one. So yeah, so whatever your wins are for 2022, go ahead and journal about those. It's been too long ago. Where did we go wrong? Too late to turn around. Where are you now? Where are you now? Hey, it's been too long. And these can be personal wins as well. It doesn't have to be real estate related. I see a lot of writing, which is awesome. I love that. So you guys all did an amazing job this year. Whether you believe it or not, you all have something to celebrate, and you all really accomplished some great things this year. And I'm really excited to see that you guys are recognizing that by all of everything that you're writing down. Celebrating your 2022 wins. Okay, 10 seconds, 10 seconds. Don't worry, you get to do this again at home. Some of your 2022 wins. Don't all jump up at once. Shanti.
Okay, so this year I've done 8 conventions so far. And
I'm awesome.
3 more in place. I'm glad about that. For personal.
Bravo.
I have my son.
Yes.
And then just managing my business with work it.
Awesome. And then can we add coaching?
Yes.
That's a win, right? She's one of our coaches. All right, let's give her a big round of applause. Woo! Awesome. All right, who else wants to share? Karen.
So in business, I activated my real estate license to active after having had it for 5 years. I left a job where I was starting to feel restricted and suffocated. I joined La Rosa, really felt seen, trained, part of a family. I created a brand and started marketing in my target neighborhood. For personal, I got to spend my first summer in like 3 years with my kids.
Awesome.
So really nice.
Cool.
I'm possibly going to be going to school next year.
Nice.
And then spiritually, I really learned to manage my anxiety, which came in part to leaving a job. And
awesome. Those are awesome wins. Love that. Ice.
Oh, in business, yes. I love my goal and love it to not with my friends. So, and I love the networking. 1 year later, when I was talking to some people, I'm real good with everything now.
Good.
At the end of the year. So, I right now approach everything in the marketing. So, we can let my material kind of comes back. And I'm going to do my farming in the person now, the great one, when my husband had a great surgery, which felt hurt. Now he can hear it.
All right, one more share, Maria.
Okay, so finally, I was able to do TikTok this year.
Great, I finally put and you're live on TikTok. Look at that.
So yes, I was finally in social media all over. I was able to make it a 6-figure income this year. I increased my international buyers, my investors. I did. I bought myself an out-of-state property that I was able to sell it for over $100,000 in profit. I create a type of customers, buyers and sellers from inside the United States and outside the United States. I did 200 miles.
Yes.
That was great. And finally, I just came back from a beautiful, worth it vacation that I haven't taken 2 years. I just came from Italy and Spain.
Awesome. Woo! Those are some great wins. Good job, Maria. So proud of you.
Okay, I have to.
Yes.
Another big thing for my business is coming to this little office. That was a celebration for Treasure Hunt Christmas. And then I forgot.
Yeah! Awesome! Raise your hand. Who bought a home in 2022? Okay.
I did.
Who bought a home in 2022?
But
that's okay. You bought a house. So 2 people bought a house. All right. Awesome. Awesome, guys. Awesome job. All right. Keep these wins in mind when we move on to the next section. And that up there, I'm not going to turn the lights off, but what got in the way? So those are awesome. Awesome wins. But I know some of you maybe didn't share because maybe you're like, wow, I really didn't do what I wanted to do, right? I really said that I was going to do this in 2022 and I didn't do it. Or there's things that I really didn't get to. So we're going to journal a little bit about what got in the way from the goals that we were not able to accomplish in 2022. Okay, so we're going to take about 3-4 minutes to do this. Again, I highly recommend you guys do this exercise at home because we need to identify and don't just be like, well, time management. First of all, there's a new motto in this office, and that is there's no such thing as time management. There's something called choice management, right? So no one's allowed to say those words, right? You can't blame it on that because those are your choices. You can stand up and say, I had a choice management problem. You are allowed to say that. All right, so Nestor, music up, and let's just journal about what got in the way. What we didn't accomplish, and it's okay to, write down, I wanted to do this, what got in the way of that? 3 to 4 minutes of this. All right.
That's not in this place.
All right, let's talk about who wants to share here, who wants to be vulnerable and kind of talk about something that you didn't achieve in 2022 that you wanted to, and identify what got in the way. I saw Shander's hand go up.
I made like a 5-day decision to go ahead and get my real estate license after having my application in for 2 years.
Okay.
And because I had a lot of pre-planned activities, I feel like I'm like running on the hamster wheel.
Okay.
But being here today, it's like I have to be there no matter what. I mean, I have to fly. Yeah. Well, that's awesome. So, awesome. I'm here.
Yes. Awesome. I love that. All right, who else wants to share something that they didn't accomplish in 2022 and what got in the way? Everyone crushed their goals? Ice.
I want to buy the house. It wasn't the goal for 2022, but it's my goal for the end of 2023.
Okay.
So I'm talking to my mom myself as a brand to work on it.
Okay.
And I want to meet my family in Kazakhstan and get my citizenship.
Awesome. Okay. So those are what you want to do in 2023. Okay, perfect. All right, good. We're gonna talk more about that too in a minute. All right, anyone, last chance, anyone wants to share what they didn't get to accomplish in 2022 and what got in the way? Miss Holmes, Tiffany.
Okay, what got in the way? I have to say myself, I get in the way of myself all the time. I am an overthinker. I overthink everything from a social media post to showing up for coaching every Tuesday with Carrie. So I think it's just my mind, it's my mindset. And I'll just do it, it'll be okay and let it land. So, and also maybe that's one thing I got in the way of myself. Sacrifices. I think I just didn't sacrifice as much as I should. Really, because sometimes you think about finances, you think about time, you think about this. You know what? Just let it bleed out. Just do it. Just go for it. And I think, you know, that will be part of my plan in 2023. And I got in the way also, like, I wanted to graduate from coaching this year. That's a plan, but I'm okay with that. And I'm just going to, you know, do what I need to do. So I'm going to regroup, restart, and so next year will be a lot better. So I think those are the things that got in the way. And I think self, I got in the way of myself, you know, so that's what I'm talking
about. And that's hard to share that. That's hard to say, you know. I didn't achieve anything that I wanted to do in 2022. And what got in the way with me is just choices, like choosing what to focus my time on, and also kind of like, so it's a combination, I think, for me, like between like procrastination and being the kind of person that when there's not much to do, I don't do anything. But when I have a lot to do and it's last minute, then you kind of see me being like this. But I mean, for me too, I mean, there's a lot of stuff that I didn't do in 2022. And yes, we still have quarter four. So we all get to kind of identify what that is today, but I really wanted to break 100 agents in this office and I didn't do that yet. And there's really no reason I couldn't.
Yeah.
Very close. Yeah, we're always somewhere between like 94 and 99 agents. We're always hovering between 94 and 99. But anyway, the point is that what got in the way is really kind of like choosing how I spend my time and how much time I need to be spending on recruiting. And I'll be honest with you, when Nestor and I built our business plan for 2022, some really crucial things changed throughout the year. And that really screwed up my mindset and I never went back and readjusted. So this is something really important that I want to share with you guys. Is that we're gonna make a business plan, we're gonna talk about all the little cute numbers and put them all in the little cute boxes, but you have got to every single quarter look at what is going on and reevaluate and change. And that's why people like, what is your 5-year goal? I hate that question because it's the stupidest question I've ever heard of. Nobody can ever foresee what's gonna happen in 5 years, right? This is a really good lesson for the younger people in here too. Like life does not work that way. You know, 2 years ago, we had a whole pandemic. I mean, that changed everybody's business plan. So you've got to be able to pivot. You've got to be able to kind of change, and you've got to always, you can't just make it and set it and be like, that's my plan, it's over there. You got to look at it every quarter and really adjust. And maybe you need to adjust what your goals are as well. Sometimes we come out of the gate and we're like, oh, these are my goals. And you get through quarter one and you're like, oh, wow, I don't have the time because I'm a mom and I have another full-time job to really do what it takes to meet these goals. I've got to be realistic because I don't want to lose my family time, right? I can't quit my job. So I've got to readjust and maybe readjust my goals and then readjust the way that you look at going against it. Yes, Gene.
I don't know if you remember sometimes some years back that we did the joint job.
Yep.
And he suggested that we did the year plan for next year.
Yep.
And mail it, build it, or mail it.
Yeah.
He would take it and a copy of it and he would mail it back.
Yeah.
Order after we put that.
Yeah.
Which was interesting because he said, what are you going to do?
Yeah.
What you want to do. And then you check with what you actually didn't do.
Yeah.
With what was your plan.
Yeah.
That's a good idea.
I love that. Yeah. We could do that here too. So, and it's true, like, I don't know, Gene and I are in a little competition here. Who's been to how many, who's been to the more amount of do it nows? But yeah, so what, if you've never taken Joe LaRosa's do it now, you've got to do it now. You've got to take it. But yeah, he would have us and put it in a sealed envelope with our name and our address on it. And then like 7-8 months later, we get something in the mail. And I have all of mine, you guys. And one day I'll share them with you because it's hysterical. Like, I'll do that. Maybe in part two of this class, I'll dig up mine and read back to you what was mailed back to me in 2015-16, and it's wild. So, but anyway, we have to always be readjusting. So we want to make a nice, big, rock solid plan, but understand that it's okay if things don't go the exact way that you're going to do in your plan. All right. So before we get into new lead generation techniques, I want to kind of go off of what Tiffany shared, and I'm gonna teach Tiffany how she can use this in a little quick exercise that we're gonna do. So people are motivated either by pleasure or by pain. And one of those motivations are stronger for you than the other, and not everybody is the same. Some people,
Ron?
I think so. Some people are very motivated by pleasure, about like the big fancy cars and the boats and the trips and the bling and the shoes. And some people are very motivated by the pain. Like, oh my gosh, if I don't do this, I can't put food on the table. I'm gonna have to go get another job, or I'm gonna have to quit real estate, right? So real quick, there's no real room for you to do this in your packet. So just flip over one piece of paper and draw like a line so that you have like two things, right? So the top will be pleasure and the bottom will be pain. So you're gonna need a whole thing, a whole piece of paper. We're gonna be artists for the next 60 seconds. And you're gonna kind of draw a picture of what pleasure looks like to you, right? When you're making it in real estate and killing all your goals, like what is it a boat? Is it vacation? Is it a big house? Is it, you know, what is it? And then you're gonna, and you're drawing this for a reason. You're gonna describe what the pain is. So, and Tiffany, since you shared, I'm gonna use you as an example. Like maybe that pain of Tiffany is having like a picture of everyone else at graduation, but not her. And no, but not, and it's right. But use this as a tool, because I really highly recommend that you guys keep something beside your desk when you're lead generating. And have that there so that you're constantly like, oh, I don't want to call that person. And then Tiffany is going to see that little picture of her, like not at graduation. She's like, I got to get on the phone. Like, I got to do that more. So next we're going to turn the music up a little bit. You're going to spend literally a minute and a half, you guys, just like drawing two little pictures. What does pleasure look like for you? And what does pain look like for you guys? Like, what's painful if you don't reach your real estate goals? Don't worry, you don't have to share the drawings with people, so no one's going to see what you drew. You're just
this one of those songs you can play over and over again, and it can still give you that feeling of a good time you had. Or
my 2023 goal is to be able to get Spotify with no ads.
That's where he hung in on the sound.
And YouTube and Pandora and all the rest. Yeah, it's going to be my goal. draw your pleasure and your pain. And it's meant to be on one piece of paper. Again, you're drawing what pleasure looks like to you. Like when you make it in real estate, like what is that? What do you have? Maybe you have a big old crown on your head. A boat, a car, what does pain look like? Like I can't, like I can't put food on the table. I have to get another job. Maybe pleasure for you is quitting that job and being a realtor full time. All right, 30 seconds. All right. Nestor. Thank you. All right. So you guys, it is true. You guys are motivated more by pleasure or pain, one or the other. Not everybody is the same. I will go first. I will share with you. Who thinks that I'm motivated by pleasure? Raise your hand. If it's definitely, raise your hand tall. Who thinks, if you had to pick me, now you guys all know me, I'm your broker. Do you think I'm motivated more by pleasure or pain? Who says pleasure? 3, 4, 5. Danielle's not sure. Who thinks I'm motivated by pain? Oh, you're my people. Yeah. I could care less about a fancy, but pain, like if I'm in trouble, if someone's looking at me and being like, if a certain someone has a conversation with me, like, hey, you're not recruiting the way you should be, or, something's not right. Your agents are upset. You're not doing enough classes for them. Like that's, I'm motivated by that, right? But some people are motivated by pleasure more. I'll throw Nestor on the spot. Who thinks Nestor is more motivated by pain or pleasure? Let's see, Nestor, pleasure. Pain. Pleasure. Yeah. Uh-huh. Want the shiny things, yeah. Okay, so who wants to share whether they think they're motivated more by pleasure or pain, and then kind of describe what they wrote on their paper? Mitzi.
I am definitely motivated by pleasure.
Okay.
This year, I've been to Dubai on a cruise. Two more cruises coming up by the end of the year.
Hold on, Mitzi, we don't have enough. Hold on, wait. We don't have enough time in this class to talk about all your vacations. No, I'm just kidding.
So that's what motivates me.
Yeah.
To travel, to go places.
Okay.
It's also what has stood in my way of doing what I needed to do for 2022. So my plan to change that, I've already started planning my travel for next year, and I have to readjust that because I'm.
Okay, hold on. I'm not going to let you get away with this. who thinks that she has to sacrifice what she truly loves for vacations to have the business that she really wants? Nobody. You do not have to. You have to change the choices you're making while you're working, but you don't need to cut out your vacations and cut out the things that truly make you happy, your life. You get to readjust what you do when it's your work time. But you don't have to say, well, I can't do 9 vacations this year because
I need more of Tiffany then.
Okay, but you know what? You just described maybe you need to build a small team. Maybe you need to outsource some of the stuff. Guys, so there's a lot of people in the room that don't remember this moment. There's some people in the room that do. There was a time when I was the only coach in this office. I was a broker. I was the only coach. I did the compliance. We didn't even have a cleaning lady in the office. I cleaned the bathroom. I was here mopping the floors. Like I couldn't grow until I started like outsourcing some of that. And it hurt. I was like, can we afford a cleaning lady? Like how much do they charge? Like, course we can. And then we started paying Sydney to do compliance. Like, we hired all these other fabulous coaches for the office. So maybe that's what you really need to do, is focus on what, you know, what your money-making activities are. And we're going to, this is exactly the segment that we're getting into. But I don't want you to automatically think that you need to sacrifice that for this. It's working smarter, not harder.
I actually love hearing you say that, because I have a lot of, I left my job because I wanted to be part of something else.
Yeah.
And then I started this, and I'm like, well, I have to also maybe find a better balance, because I feel like right now, school just started, there was a lot of activities, I was really focused on that. And I'm like, maybe I need to do more of those things. That's really what I want, right? I do want to be successful.
Right.
But just hearing you say that was just kind of
fun. Yeah.
Because they're both important.
Exactly. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
I want to share something as a, one of the top agents here in the office. I want to say that the moment I decided to have an assistant, I was able to actually increase my business. So everybody that actually gets to a point where they feel that they're getting overwhelmed with all the leads that they come through or the appointments that they have to, it's a time for you guys to start getting somebody. I started with a part-time and ended with a full-time. And it is important for you to have help, because the most important thing is that you are out there looking for clients.
Awesome. So I want to go back to Mitzi. So what were your two photos? Like, what is the pleasure photo? You don't need to show us, because right. We won't be able to tell what it looks like, I'm sure. But yes. What's your pleasure? What's your pain photo? Like, what's the picture in your mind?
My pleasure was sitting on the beach with a drink.
Okay.
And there's the sunshine, yeah. There's a boat.
Okay.
So that's yeah. The pain is a little bit of money.
Yeah.
A bag of money, but it's shrunk. The pain is falling off my car.
Yeah. Okay. Awesome. Who one more share? Who wants to share if they're motivated more by pleasure or pain, and what your two images were on your paper? Shandra. You have your hand half raised, and no one else had half hands. So
the pain would be single parents, not necessarily single moms, single parents standing in line trying to figure out what they're going to say. What that means is my goal is to have single homes so they can have a tenant for whatever they can bring their home.
Okay. I love that. I mean, it's beautiful. You and I had conversations about your journey.
Right.
Okay. I'm trying to think if you should go more inward, like what's painful for you, not for the people that you don't help.
Empty pockets.
Okay, great. Right. And then I'm thinking it kind of makes sense, because you're tying in your why, but you're gonna get paid for doing that. So yeah, okay. What was your pleasure?
Pleasure is to sit home and have an olive name.
Okay.
Pull back.
Cool. And what are you most motivated by, do you think? Pleasure or pain?
Pain.
Pain.
Seeing where I came from and knowing that I can rebuild my own life.
Yeah.
Pain.
Yeah. Awesome. So what you guys should do, again, homework assignment number 974, create something or have a picture of something and keep it next to your desk when you're working. And have pain on one side, pleasure on the other. It could be something you draw, it could be a picture that you take, it could be something, but keep it. And when you're working and you're like, I really don't want to do this, or maybe I'm going to go change the laundry, or I really don't feel like going to the office, and I was going to try to go, like, look at those photos and see what motivates you more. Figure it out for real, and then ditch the one that doesn't motivate you and focus on the one that does, and keep that next to your desk when you're making your dun 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 cold calls. All right, so let's talk about some new lead generation. Again, guys, these are not new lead generation tactics, and I have invented nothing. Anything I'm saying here, it's because I either learned it, watched it, or borrowed or stole it, and we're bringing that content to you guys. But I don't think there's anything in here that I've invented. There's no secret pill on new lead generation. It's just really trusting the process and doing what it is that we already know that we should be doing. So Nestor is going to kill the lights, or Sydney, or whoever's out there. And we're going to talk about something that maybe you guys have not tried yet, and kind of what this looks like. We're going to talk about geofarming.
Oh, great.
Okay. Geofarming. So what is geofarming? So what it basically is you're going to pick an area, and you're going to do kind of like what we talked about with the realtor experiment, right? You're going to saturate that area and really try to become the agent of that area. So what's the number one thing that holds people back from farming a certain area?
Cold calling.
No.
You already think someone.
Yes. Say that again.
You think another agent.
You, there's already an agent there. Oh, that agent's been in. Nestor, can you turn the music down, please? Thank you. Oh, that agent's already got their foot in the door. They've been there 10 years. That's mindset training 101. It doesn't matter if they're there. People are going to want to work with you because what? Because of who you are. Sydney and I could stand side by side, right? And there, and a stranger comes in the room. They may want to work with Sydney because, you know, Sydney, I'm old too, but Sydney is an older person. He's been in real estate for a really long time, and he has that kind of powerful, distinguished look. And people are going to gravitate towards Sydney maybe because they're looking for that type of person. Someone else might come in the room, and they find out I'm from Boston, and that we have a lot in common, and we have a certain way, our people up there. So maybe they want to work with me for that, right? Maybe they find out that I'm involved in a lot of nonprofit and giving back, and they really like that about me, and that aligns with their values, and so they want to work with me. So people want to work with people for different reasons all the time. So don't let that stop you from geofarming an area. However, you guys want to do your research when you're picking your area. Do not pick an area that is hard for you to get to. And, you know, we are all guilty of this because we are like, oh, where do you work? I work Tri-County. And boy, some of you guys sure do. Because, you know, I had people calling me just with this past hurricane. I'm under contract with a property in Venice. And I'm like, Venice? Okay. Someone else was in Naples. Someone else has a property under contract in Titusville. And someone else is in PSL. And that's okay. You guys are allowed to work the whole entire state. And deals are going to come to us and we're going to go, wow, do I really want to drive to Palm Bay? And like, yeah, I guess I'll do it. But you don't want to farm those areas, right? You want to be the, you want it to be local to where you are, because you want to be able to get to areas really quickly. You want to be able to get to listing appointments at the drop of a hat. But also, what's the number one reason why you want to farm the area where you live? You know it, guys. You know the best restaurants. You know the events. You know what's happening.
Huh? And when you don't know it either.
Exactly. And if you don't know your area, that's number one, is you've got to start learning your area. All right, so screenshot this. So let's talk about some of these. I'm going to read off my screen. So identify the farm area and why, all right? Also, you know, unfortunately, if you live in Southwest Ranches, and, you know, maybe it would be okay to farm that area, but there's not a lot of real estate there, right? So you might want to say, okay, I'm going to work Davie and Cooper City and, you know, or pick a neighborhood there. You also want to be very careful. So one of the easiest ways to make more money every year, what's the way that you can make more money in 2023 without increasing your transaction amount? So like Shanti, I think, is going to do 12, 13 deals this year. How can she make more money in 2023, but still only do 12 deals? Correct. Working in a farm area where the houses cost more money. Because now she's going to go from making $9,000 for every commission check she had to making $15,000 or even $20,000. So increasing that. So you want to look at a farm area. Unfortunately, maybe you don't want to farm an area where the price of the home is not as high as some other areas, even if that's where you live. Okay. So the area that I'm going to be farming in 2023 is where I live, and that's the Alphabet in Lake Worth Beach. Now I'm going to tell you, there's a guy there, and my own neighbors who know that I'm a realtor or broker tell me, have said this like to my face, because I'm also in my homeowners association group or whatever. She's like, oh, Brett Taylor, he's the one that all of us go to sell the house. And I was like, okay, you can keep that story, and I'm going to change that story in 2023 because there's a new sheriff in town, right? Yeah. So that's okay. Brett Taylor, if you're watching, I haven't met you yet, but I'm going to take you out for coffee. That's step number one. But it's okay because there's plenty of room for both of us. And maybe people want to work with Brett Taylor because of who Brett Taylor is, but you know what? Maybe when they get to know me, they're going to want to work with me instead. So you don't know that. So don't let those fears get in the way. Don't let that mindset get in the way when we're talking about farming. All right. So here's some ideas. Now, this is what we're going to start talking about, a lot of ideas, you guys. And some of these you might look at and go, I don't want to do that. or someone's like, oh, I already do that and it doesn't work. Well, maybe you get to do it better. But also, this is the time, as we're going through this, other ideas are going to pop into your mind, and I want you to jot those down and then share with the group, because these are, again, these are just some ideas on how to farm an area, and it might spawn something that you guys can think of. So creating a newsletter. So you want to create a hyper local focused newsletter of what's going on in your area. It could be town meetings, who's running for whatever. It could be the events that are happening, new construction that's happening. And I don't just mean apartments or rentals or homes for sale. It could be stores that are coming in and out, the best restaurants, traffic patterns. It could be anything, but you want to start to create a newsletter that is super hyper-focused to your local area. You guys are very lucky, because if you have KB Core, there's already a template in there that has it. You guys just need to take out the German terms and put in the American thing and kind of create a template that you can use month after month. So again, we're not going to teach that today, but just know that that's there. And if we need to do a class on that, just reach out to me. But there's already a template in there, and it's literally just swapping out different photos, different headlines, and just taking out that German subtext and putting it in your own. So you can make a digital newsletter. However, when you're working with a geo area, when you're farming, consider really hyper-focusing on maybe like a couple neighborhoods and actually printing it and going door to door and bringing it to people. Because then it's kind of adding that personal touch. Yes, does this cost more money? Absolutely. So some of this is not going to be in your budget, or maybe you're like, you know what, I'm going to go through the first half of the year and do it digitally only. But my goal is that the second half of the year, I'm going to be able to do this in print. And don't, guys, don't overload people with content either. You want it to be kind of like, because remember, you're going to do one every month, right? So there's different things you could, maybe you highlight one restaurant a month, one new event, and maybe, you know, something else. But and again, these are just ideas, but consider looking at a budget that would include printing something and actually handing it to a smaller part of that farm area. Okay, so local events, restaurants, market reports. So that's another thing. A monthly market report could go out to all the homeowners in your farm area. Doesn't have to be fancy. It could be emailed if you get people's emails, or again, it could be just giving it to them. A market report on their house. Maybe they're, you know, and again, guys, maybe they're never going to sell their house, right? But if Karen's in my neighborhood and I'm giving her a monthly report, and then Karen's like at wherever, and she's like, oh, you know, someone's talking to her, and it's like, I need a real estate agent. Well, the number one realtor in our area is Carrie. Don't you get her monthly thing? Oh, you don't? Let me give you her phone number. And she's the number one agent. Because remember that realtor experiment, right? Remember that realtor experiment. Ann and Hermes are like basically brand new. But if you guys apply a marketing plan like this, nobody's going to know the difference, right? Okay. Print newsletter, we talked about that. Email the newsletter to your entire database. So when you create this newsletter, email it out to everybody. Even if somebody doesn't live in Davie and you have a Davie newsletter, email it to everybody anyway, because remember, you're just staying top of mind and your signature's in there. And then if you can, send one quarterly postcard, right? How many quarters are in a year? Four. So start there. That wants to be like the lowest part. But don't send a postcard if you're not doing anything else in your farm area. I repeat that again. Do not waste your precious money on postcards if it's not part of a bigger plan. Because what does everybody do with the postcard? They're going to throw them out. And you have literally, statistically, I think if they say 2 seconds to grab somebody's attention before you put it in there. So also when you're creating your postcard, don't put a bunch of stuff on there. You want to have like one or two taglines of catchy things. And then like on the flip side, your contact, call me for an interview, something like that. So don't hyper, like, you know, it's not a newsletter and a postcard. A postcard is supposed to be a follow-up to everything else that you guys are doing. But do not spend money on postcards if it's not part of the bigger plan. Otherwise, it doesn't, people are like, who's this dude? You know, like, who's this lady? But if they see like, oh, I got, you know, she was on, you know, social media, and then I saw her, you know, thing at this, and she had a little appreciation party, and then I get this monthly thing, and then I'm getting this email, and now I get the postcard, it's going to make more sense. Okay. So when you do that as part of your geo, it's four, one every quarter, but you can also always do more. The 8x8 is what really won that one experiment we talked about. A quarterly proof of production. So I love this one. So every quarter, send out something about your production. I'm waiting for it. I'm waiting for the question. Because I know someone's going to say it.
Yeah, if you don't have a production, what do you do?
Yeah, if you don't have a production, what do you do? You talk about your office stats. Now you're really going to look good. La Rosa Realty. Hi, I'm Danielle with La Rosa Realty Beaches. In September, we had 50 closings. We helped 50 families get home ownership. Reach out to us today so we can help you get your home of your dreams. Okay? So how do you guys find out our company statistics? Come to the branch meeting every month. That's the only time we give you those numbers. And no, it's not recorded. And no, we're not going to email it to you. Show up to the meeting. Huh? Or call Mister. Yeah, don't ask me. So your quarterly proof of production, and maybe you only have one sale, right? And so you could say, hey, my office, you know, our office did this, and this is the spotlight listing of the month, and it could be yours. Okay, so get creative there. Don't forget to rely on your office for statistics for that. Bi-weekly email blast about the market. How important is that now? Guys, it is our job to be educating these sellers. I'm sorry, but if they're never going to change until us realtors really kind of break it down for them, and they can't just hear it once. And a lot of the time, like when you're at a listing appointment, they say try to be like the third person, because the first person comes in and they're like, they leave. That realtor was crazy. She said I can only get $400,000 for a house. I'd never choose her. Second realtor comes in, $400,000. Oh man, another crazy realtor. I wonder if they're onto something. Third guy comes in, $400,000. Wow, I guess this must be okay. Let me sign your agreement. I'm gonna hire you. So it's all of our jobs. I'm getting off topic a little bit here, but it's all of our jobs to educate those sellers right now. And you can do that by these bi-weekly email reports.
I have a question.
Yes.
That. Now that the market has changing and is still continuing changing, mm-hmm. people that will have listing appointments where the sellers are still thinking that they still in the seller's market, that bi-weekly, you think so is going to be an impact for them to realize
it's going to help, because you're showing statistics. And don't wait for SunStats. I love SunStats and they're great to study, but the data is too late. It comes out on the 15th of the month after it already happened.
What about Forest Matters?
Okay, but that's also national, right? So you want to focus. Remember, we're talking about farming. You want to focus on whatever area of Miami or whatever. Okay. So now you're going to look up, okay, how many days on market, how many prices were reduced. And that's going to go in your bi-weekly. Hey, guys, just wanted to let you know that in XYZ neighborhood, we had 29 new listings. The average days on market is 70 days. And 30 properties lowered their price by 2%. I mean, these are the statistics that are going to make sellers go, what do you mean they lowered the price? Yes. Hello, wake up. But yes, so these are some statistics. But again, we're talking about farming. So you want to be super specific in your area. So again, me, Lake Worth Beach, Alphabet. I'm constantly looking there every single day. Maybe not every day, but every other day or at least a few times a week. And I'm looking at certain things. I'm looking at how many new listings are on the market, how many closed, days on the market, right? How long are these houses and the days on the market? How many properties have lowered the price? And you go into property history and look, you know, I'm really doing the work. So I know a lot of you guys like to rely on outside sources and getting all this information. You guys have to do this yourself. It's your job. And this is the type of stuff that you should be doing, not cleaning the bathroom, right? In my case. Right? Like this. But I'm using that as an example. Like, but don't do the, like, we had the Real Grader presentation yesterday, and some of you I know are like, I'm going to go watch YouTube videos and figure out how to do. You're going to spend all this time when you should be doing something else and generating more business to the point where you're like, $900, no problem. Here's my credit card. I'm happy for you guys to do it. You're the professionals in this.
But when you're talking about giving these statistics, I know that when we go on the MLS, they give us the complete breakdown from that one, but they are only for the full entire account.
I'm saying, how do you do it? You literally go into the MLS and you search. So put in the search within 2 miles of whatever address, like I pick mine, right? Okay. So I pick my address and I say, hey, show me the 2 mile radius around where I live. I live in Lake Worth Beach. And I'm looking at those, and then I'm going through every freaking single listing. I'm clicking, I'm watching TV, and I'm doing this like at night or in the morning, and I'm clicking, I'm drinking my coffee in the morning, and I'm clicking. I'm like, another price reduction, another price reduction, another price reduction. Okay, all right, so I just saw 12 price reductions. Okay, how many sold? Now I'm looking at the list price and the sold price. Okay, well, these didn't sell list, this didn't sell list, oh, this sold at list, this didn't sell list. I'm doing the work myself. You're literally looking at it. So days on market, how many listings came to market? How many listings lowered their price but are still active? How many listings went pending? And then when they closed, I'm looking at what the data was, how many days on market, and then what it sold for compared to what it listed for. You guys don't have to be like Nestor with the perfect number, but you could say, oh, well, you know, five properties had to lower their price. Five properties sold under list price. You don't have to get like, it was a 12% increase. Like if you could figure that out, great, but it's just, it's the data. And then put that in the bi-weekly email blast to your database.
What are the metrics again?
So I look at how many new listings to the market, how many days on the market active listings have.
That will work by the zip code.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah, that's a lot of properties. So that's again, we're talking about farming right now. So farming is supposed to be, let me give you a parameter, and this can be different for everybody, but I'm going to give you a guideline, guys. It's very vague. I talk about a farm between like 300 to 800 is what we're talking about homes. It's a very focused, hyper-focused area. 300 might be a little, but it depends. So how many active listings there are, how many new listings came to the market, what the days on market are. How many properties had to decrease their price since it's been on the market? And then how many properties that closed sold for under list price? Okay. Brand leave behind. So what is that? It's a Popeye, right? So I want you guys to think, and again, so we're kind of talking about these new generation, but this whole bigger picture class is about your 2023 business plan. So I want you guys to spend a lot of time on thinking, what is your cost-effective brand leave behind? What is it that you're going to buy in bulk? And that's going to be your go-to thing that you're leaving, maybe for expireds or maybe, you know, at different stages in your career. Popeye can be used for many things. Maybe you buy a whole thing of mugs for super cheap for the whole entire year, and then you get the what machine is it, and you can put the little logo on it or something like that. Or is it correct, or is it little mesh bags that you're buying in bulk on Amazon because you're going to be stuffing them with something that you're going to give away? So we're not going to talk about that. There's many classes that we do here on Popeyes and all on how to do this, but this should be something in your business plan about your brand leave behind and what it is that you're using, because in your farm area is where it makes sense. It doesn't make sense to all of a sudden, I live in Lake Worth Beach, for me to drive up to Port St. Lucie and one day randomly door knock an area and leave a little mug. Like I'm not doing anything else in that area, so it doesn't make sense. It does make sense when you're doing this for your sphere of influence. So like Karen's really good. She's like doing that with her school, like that school. She doesn't live in the school, but she's bringing it to the school. Some other people, like husband's a firefighter, they're constantly bringing stuff to the fire station. Okay, that is your sphere. But when you're talking about a geo area, this is not your sphere. This is an area that you're trying to saturate. And you also want to have a brand leave behind there. So spend time and talk about that. I'm actually going to, after the slide, I'm going to give us like 3 minutes to kind of work together and brainstorm about different ideas so you guys can get ideas together. Fridge magnet with the trash. Oh, I spelled trash wrong. Okay. With your trash schedule. Okay, trash schedule. Yeah, with my Boston accent. Okay, so car magnets. The fridge magnets, right? So everybody gets the one with the Miami Dolphin thing. Guys, if you're doing a geo farm, I promise you, I have to ask Nestor every day, what comes today? Have this made into a magnet and give that to people with your card on it. That is an awesome, awesome idea of a leave behind. Because that also never changes, right? Miami Dolphins, you got to do that every year. And I love that too. I love the football. I love the sports calendars. But if you make something like this, this will stay on that fridge for 2 years. And sometimes that's how long it takes for someone to decide that they're going to be a seller or a new buyer, right?
What's the last one? Dun, dun, dun. Fridge magnet.
I think it said sports. Yeah. Yeah, and there's again, this is just a couple ideas, but it's supposed to get you guys thinking. Okay, so what I want you guys to do is get in groups of four, kind of just turn your chairs or wheel your chairs around. Nestor will turn there, Sydney will turn the lights on. Get in groups of four or five or something. Get in like a couple of mini groups and talk about some Popeye ideas that you can be doing for your sphere, what you guys are doing, what's working, and also kind of talk about some ideas that you can do for your farming area as far as your brand need behind. What happened? What happened?